members of the Order of the British Empire.
Great to see you all here, and I hope this week will definitely motivate you. It's gonna be a really great week for me, and hopefully for you as well. So without further ado, I invite Director of Center for Physical Sciences and Technology to give a welcome word.
Dear professors, dear guests and colleagues, on behalf of the Center for Physical Science and Technology, I would like to welcome all of you here at the beautiful conference Open Readings 2017. Inspired by young scientists and PhD students, the conference has experienced strong positive evolution during the last decade. And from the local event, the conference was converted to the international phenomenon, attracting young and brave minds from Europe. That is why I would like to express highest possible appreciations for invited professors, for their time, for their coming, for their knowledge, insights, and experience. And all of us are very grateful for organizers of the conference, not only making this event possible, but to feel beauty of physics and to stimulate particular atmosphere here at our lovely Sunrise Valley. We wish you a nice conference, very productive time, and enlightening discussions. Thank you.
Now I have the honor to introduce John Ellis, who is currently Clerk Maxwell Professor of Theoretical Physics at the King's College in London. He was awarded the Maxwell Medal in 1982 and the Paul Dirac Prize in 2005 by the Institute of Physics. John was elected Fellow of the Royal Society of London in 1985 and of the Institute in Physics in 1991, and he is an honorary fellow of the King's College in Cambridge and at the King's College London. John got his PhD in Cambridge in theoretical high energy particle physics. After short postdoc positions in SLAC, that is the Stanford Linear Accelerator Center, and Caltech, California Institute of Technology, John went to CERN, where he was a staff scientist from 1978 to 2011. He still works at CERN, making him an active scientist longer than most people work in their whole lifetime. CERN made a very good choice, as John Ellis contributed significantly and essentially to the success of several experiments at CERN. NA31 and NA48, probably you have not heard the names, measured the direct CP violation in the Kaon system, and, well, I'm not sure if these experiments would have been that successful if not John Ellis could have given the guidance. LEP, which laid the ground for the accuracy of the standard understanding of the standard model, our today's standard, was a success because John Ellis helped to form the search patterns for the experiments. And LHC, which finally found the Higgs boson, also wouldn't work as it would without him. But not only CERN profited from John's scientific enthusiasm. Also, the discovery of the gluon in DESY can be attributed to his contribution to connect theory to experiment. In over 1,000 papers with over 70,000 citations, John connects fundamental theoretical concepts and questions with the experimental analysis. He is Mr. Phenomenology. So if you want to know how some theoretical effect can be seen in an experiment, ask John Ellis. And so I don't want to stop any more his words, because that's much more important than my introduction. So please, I would ask you to take your long talk.
Okay, thank you. So there are still some seats here if people want to sit down. Of course, if you want to stay close to the exit, that's okay too. Okay, so I'd like to thank the organizers for bringing me back to Lithuania after a gap of more than a decade. It's a pleasure to be back here. So the organizers gave me this very ambitious title, A Brief Introduction to Everything. Well, you know, everything, the universe is quite old, 13.8 billion years. It's rather large, 10 to the 8 to 20 centimeters across. So to explain everything is an impossible task. And I'm certainly not going to explain Donald Trump. Instead, what I want to do is to focus on three fundamental questions about the universe. What is the universe made of? What happened close to the beginning of the universe? And at least a little bit about what will happen to the universe, or what might happen to the universe in the future, assuming that Donald Trump doesn't get us first. So when I'm talking about this topic to a general audience, I often like to refer back to this famous painting by this famous painting showing people asking very basic questions about us and our place in the universe. So these people are asking themselves, where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? And those three questions, of course, map precisely onto the three scientific questions that I had in the first slide. What happened at the beginning of the universe? What is the universe made of? And what is the future of the universe? And I would argue that the aim of particle physicists, specifically of experiments at CERN, is to address these questions. And I might say that I had a copy of this painting on my wall when I was a PhD student, just to remind me why I came into work every day, and I guess that's still why I come into work every day. Okay, so let's look at the various distance scales in the universe that we want to be thinking about. So on this slide here, you see scales going all the way from the total size of the universe down to 10 to the minus 32 centimeters. That's the sort of smallest scale that we theoretical physicists care to speculate about, the scale that might have been important at the very beginning of the Big Bang. And then somewhere halfway along this logarithmic scale, we have the human scale. So this is a picture of Albert Einstein and his kid sister, you know, about a meter tall. So you know, roughly speaking, halfway along this logarithmic scale. So of course we know a lot about what goes on, or what went on inside Einstein and his sister. So we'll be hearing a lot about molecules later on. They're made of atoms. Atoms contain nuclei surrounded by clouds of electrons. Those nuclei are made up out of protons and neutrons. And if I'd been giving this talk 80 years ago, I probably would have said, well, okay, protons and neutrons are the fundamental particles. But of course, now we know better. We know that protons and neutrons are made up out of smaller, apparently elementary particles called quarks. So somehow, out of these fundamental constituents, the universe has constructed all the large-scale structures that we see in the universe. So stars, galaxies, clusters of galaxies. Now, actually, when astronomers look at those large-scale structures, those galaxies, those clusters of galaxies, as I'll be discussing later on, they tell us that there has to be something in addition to the visible matter that's described here. This is the infamous dark matter, and I'll be returning later on to ways in which we can hope to understand the nature of dark matter, both in collider experiments and also in direct searches. Now, looking back on the other side of Einstein, to the scale inside the protons, inside, you know, the very intimate details of matter, we can hope with our accelerator experiments to study directly the laws of physics that were operational in the very early history of the universe, in the first fraction of a second in the universe. And what we hope to do, and obviously this is very ambitious, is to link what happened in those very early epochs with what we see in the universe today. So I'm going to be talking a lot about experiments with particle accelerators. But I think it's worth remembering that this subject was born not with particle accelerators, but with cosmic rays. So it was back in 1912 that Victor Hess discovered that the Earth was being bombarded by energetic particles. He went up in this balloon. He discovered ionization, which was explained by the showers of particles produced by the impacts of these energetic primary particles produced by, if you like, cosmic accelerators. So between then and about the 1950s, most of our knowledge about the fundamental structure of matter came from those cosmic ray experiments. Many different types of particle were discovered, antiparticles, the muon, strange particles, and so on. But it was realized around the middle of the last century that if you wanted to study these particles in detail, carefully, systematically, then you needed to do it in a laboratory, and that meant building your own accelerator where you produced known particles with known energies that you could study directly. And so that was how particle accelerator laboratories were born. So what did those experiments with particle accelerators reveal? So they revealed something which we call the standard model of particle physics that Thomas already mentioned briefly in his introduction. So this is a theory, a very accurate theory. It deserves to be called a theory rather than a model, but that's somehow the name it got stuck with. Anyway, this theory was proposed by Abdus Salam, originally from Pakistan, and by two American physicists, Glashow and Weinberg, in the late 1960s. And they incorporated, in an essential way, ideas from Peter Higgs and colleagues that I'll be discussing in more detail later on. So for several years, basically nobody paid any attention to Salam, Glashow, Weinberg, Higgs, et al. But then, in the early 1970s, the first experimental results confirming a key prediction of the standard model started emerging. And if you come to CERN, you can see in front of the theory division the piece of experimental equipment where these first discoveries were made. Subsequently, as Thomas also mentioned, very detailed measurements were made, in particular at the LEP accelerator in the 1990s, which demonstrated perfect agreement between the theoretical predictions and the experimental measurements. So here, that green line there, that's a prediction of the standard model. And if you're sitting in the front row, then you can see a little dot there, which is the experimental measurement. Excellent agreement. So what does this standard model actually consist of? So it contains a bunch of matter particles. So a prototype of these, of course, is the electron. And then sitting inside the proton, as I mentioned previously, we've got the quarks. Actually, we now know that there are six different types of quark. In parallel to the electron, we have a couple of heavier, very similar particles, one called the muon, which, as I mentioned, was discovered in cosmic rays, and another one called the tau that was discovered in particle accelerators. And then in between here, we have the neutrinos. I'm not going to be saying very much about the neutrinos in my talk, although they're obviously also key elements in our recipe for making the universe. Now, in order to cook up the universe, you need not just the fundamental particles, but you also need interactions between them. And some of these, of course, are quite familiar. Gravity, which keeps even theoretical physicists' speculations firmly on the ground. Electromagnetism, which was unified by James Clerk Maxwell when he was professor at King's College London just over 150 years ago. And then, inside the world of particles, we have the weak nuclear force responsible for forms of radioactivity, and the strong nuclear force that holds protons and neutrons together inside nuclei, and quarks inside protons and neutrons. Now, I like to think of these particles and their properties as somehow the cosmic DNA. Somehow they encode all the information that you need to make all the visible stuff in the universe, even including Donald Trump, although we don't quite understand how that worked. Now, there is, however, one important ingredient missing, and that is, where do the particle masses come from? So the electron has to have a mass. If it didn't, then electrons would travel at the speed of light and they would never bind to nuclei. The particle here called W, which is responsible for the weak interactions, has a very large mass. If it didn't, radioactivity would be a strong force, life would be impossible, we'd all glow in the dark. So it was very important for the completion of the Standard Model that we understand where particle masses come from. So we all think we know something about mass, right? Newton told us that weight is proportional to mass. Einstein told us that E is equal to mc squared. But these gentlemen somehow forgot to explain where particle masses come from. And that's where this gentleman comes in. So this is Peter Higgs, who, together with two colleagues from Belgium, Robert Brout and François Englert, in 1964, proposed how particles might acquire their mass. And that's his theory on the blackboard there. And here it is on my pullover. So the whole Standard Model is on the pullover. So the top line, this is the fundamental interactions, electromagnetism, Maxwell's equations, contained in there. I hope the laser is not too strong because I don't want to burn up my pullover. The second line, that explains how the forces act on elementary particles. So if you like, the photoelectric effect. This, the third line, that's how we think particles get their masses from the Higgs field. And the bottom line, that's somehow the engine room of the Higgs-Brout-Englert mechanism. So there you are, everything on one t-shirt. Now, it's a key prediction of this theory that there should be a particle associated with this new field, phi, which was introduced by Brout, Englert, and Higgs. And it was actually only Higgs who pointed out explicitly the existence of a massive particle, and that's why we call it the Higgs boson. And just in case I forget, Peter Higgs was an undergraduate and a graduate student at King's College London, although he had the poor taste to go to Edinburgh to do his famous work. Okay, so what's the basic idea of Brout, Englert, and Higgs? So the idea is that you should imagine that the universe is filled with a field, universal, isotropic, homogeneous. So it's different from electromagnetic or gravitational field. They have specific sources. This is a universal, constant field. And you can think of it as being a sort of environment. And particles then have to travel through this environment, this medium. So some particles don't interact with the medium. And the analogy which I would propose is to think of Siberia in the middle of winter. Okay? So Siberia in the middle of winter, you've got this snowfield extending absolutely everywhere as far as the eye can see. And if you try to go through Siberia, you'd be well advised to wear skis. If you wear skis, you go very quickly. You don't interact with that Higgs snowfield. You don't sink into that Higgs snowfield. You go at the maximum speed possible, and that's like a particle with no mass that does not interact with the Higgs field. However, maybe you've got snowshoes. If you've got snowshoes, then you will sink into the snow. That's like a particle that interacts with that universal Higgs field. You go slower than the skier. That's like a particle with mass that travels at less than the speed of light, but an electron, maybe. And then finally, if you're really crazy, then you may be going to try to walk across Siberia in your boots. In that case, you're going to sink deeply into the snow. You're going to interact strongly with that Higgs field. You're going to travel much less than the speed of light, a particle with a heavy mass. So that's the basic idea. Your mass depends on how strongly you interact with this universal Higgs field. So what is snow made of? Well, it's made of snowflakes, right? So in some similar sense, there is a quantum associated with this Engler-Braut Higgs field, which is the particle that we call the Higgs boson, in the same way the photon is associated with the electromagnetic field. So here's a snowflake. Of course, there's basically an infinite number of possible snowflakes because they're made up out of molecules, which can be arranged in different ways. And in the same way, we're now arguing about whether the Higgs boson that was discovered at CERN 5 years ago is the only Higgs boson, or whether there might be many, many more Higgs bosons, and perhaps they're composite objects made up out of smaller constituents. So that's one of the debates that we're still having. So as I mentioned, this basic idea for giving particles their masses was proposed in 1964. It was incorporated in the Standard Model in 1967, 1968. The first experimental evidence for the theory came in 1973. But still, in 1975, people were not paying very much attention. But together with my colleagues, Mary Gaillard and Dimitri Nonopoulos, we said, the existence of this Higgs boson is a key prediction of the Standard Model. So what would it look like? Well, since these ideas were at the time regarded as being very speculative, we were rather cautious in the last paragraph of our paper. We do not want to encourage big experimental searches for the Higgs boson. Fortunately, our experimental colleagues did not take our bad advice. Okay, so that situates you with the Standard Model. So I'd just like briefly to map the issues outstanding in the Standard Model with the Gauguin questions that I mentioned in one of my earlier slides. So what are we? What are we made of? So the question now becomes, why do things weigh? That would be the completion of the explanation in the Standard Model of what visible matter in the universe is made out of. Where do we come from? What is the origin of matter? I mentioned the dark matter. We need to understand that if we want to understand what the universe is made of. Where do we come from? Where are we going? How does the universe evolve? I mentioned, of course, that the universe is very big and old. That's something that we would also like to understand. And, of course, we want to understand the future of the universe, which, as I will discuss, may be very closely connected with the properties of the Higgs boson that we discovered 5 years ago. So, our job as physicists, particularly as particle physicists, particularly working on the LHC, is to try to at least ask those questions. And if we find some more answers, so much the better. So, of course, in the first run of the LHC, as I'll discuss in more detail in a moment, the Higgs boson was discovered, so Peter Higgs could be happy. And currently, there's an ongoing continuing run at the LHC at higher energies called LHC Run 2, and we hope that's going to cast light on some of the other fundamental questions. So I said that with our particle experiments, we hope to cast light on what happened very early in the history of the universe. So how early? So just to remind you, when the universe was less than about 300,000 years old, there were no atoms. It was only after that that the universe cooled down sufficiently to form atoms and eventually molecules. So Ben, I'm very sorry, but you were out of business in the first 300,000 years. When the universe was less than 3 minutes old, there were no nuclei. So if there's any nuclear physicists here, sorry. If you go back when the universe was less than a microsecond old, there'd be no protons and neutrons, only quarks, gluons, and that primordial soup. And if you go back when the universe was less than a picosecond old, we think there would have been no mass. If you like, the Higgs snow field would have melted when the universe was very young. So we hope to understand dark matter, which we believe might have been released from ordinary matter somewhere between a microsecond and a picosecond after the Big Bang. And we hope that the appearance of mass through this condensation of the Higgs field might also give us some insight into the appearance of matter itself. So that's the basic program. So in order to ask and hopefully answer these questions, the Large Hadron Collider was built at CERN. So here you see the layout. So there's the Geneva Airport on the right-hand side. The tunnel here, indicated by this white oval, is about 27 kilometers in circumference. Of course, from the airplane, you don't see very much because it's all about 100 meters underground. If you go inside the tunnel, then this is what you see. You see a string of thousands of magnets curling away into the distance there. So inside those magnets, they're circulating thousands of billions of protons. Each of them has approximately the energy of a fly. And when it's in operation, they produce maybe a billion collisions per second. And in those collisions, we hope to understand the origin of mass, the nature of dark matter, and so on. So as I mentioned, the first run of the LHC discovered the Higgs boson. That was at a quote-unquote relatively low energy of 8 TeV. That's about 8,000 times the rest mass energy of the proton. And currently, we're operating at about 13 TeV with the hope of moving up to 14. And if you want to think in terms of probing the very early universe, that means going back something like three times earlier in the history of the universe. So I'm not going to say very much about the technology involved in doing this, but just a few gee whiz points. So here we're looking inside the magnets. And so you see tubes, and particles go past each other through those tubes. Those have to have a very high vacuum. In fact, the vacuum is similar to interplanetary space. The pressure in those beam pipes is less than it is on the surface of the moon. And you need that because you want the particles as they go around to collide with each other, not with molecules of gas. The magnets have to be very powerful in order to hold the particles in their orbits. Strong magnets, you require superconducting temperatures, so you require a sophisticated refrigeration system, which actually reduces the temperature inside those magnets to less than outer space. So outer space has a temperature of about 2.7 degrees above absolute zero, and the LHC magnets have a temperature of 1.9 degrees above absolute zero. So that's why I claim that particle physics is cooler than cosmology. So around this ring, there are four places where the particles collide. And at each of those points, you have a big particle detector. So CMS and ATLAS, those are the two biggest detectors that co-discovered the Higgs boson and are now looking for evidence of dark matter. Then there's LHCb, which is trying to understand the difference between matter and antimatter that may be linked to the origin of the matter in the universe. And here we have ALICE, which is studying the sort of cosmological soup that filled the universe when it was very young. So each of these experiments is operated by collaborations from scientists from many, many different countries. And I'm very glad that since my previous visit to Lithuania, Lithuania has now officially joined the CMS experiment. So this map just illustrates for you the community of scientists working at CERN. So it's not that these discoveries are made by CERN. They're made at CERN, but by communities of literally thousands of scientists from around the world. And so the blue countries here, these are members of CERN. The pale blue ones, those are the associate members. Green ones, those are big non-European countries where we have high-level agreements. And then we have other agreements with these other red countries. So in all, we have something like 60 countries participating officially in CERN research and people carrying something like 100 different passports. So, now let's review the history of the discovery of the Higgs boson. So I think it's fair to say that in 2012, when the discovery of his particle was reported, there was what one might call mass Higgsteria in the particle physics community. So what were the experiments looking for? So I remind you that when the particles in the LHC collide, they do so billions of times per second. And each of those collisions produces dozens of particles, hundreds maybe. And you have to dig out of all those particles in all those collisions the few that might be the remnants of a Higgs boson. Now, the Higgs boson is an unstable particle. You don't see it directly. You can only see what it decays into. And this is a computer simulation where the computer produced a Higgs boson that decayed into an electron-positron pair that deposited a lot of energy over there and two muons that disappeared over there. So we need very sophisticated computer systems to dig such a signal out of this, you know, immense background, and this is one area where Lithuania has been particularly contributing. So, back in 2012, the CMS and the ATLAS collaboration started reporting interesting events. So this is one example from the ATLAS experiment. So this is a computer image of the ATLAS experiment. So looking inside here, these yellow lines, those represent particle tracks. The blobs, those represent deposits of energy by neutral particles. And what you see coming out of this collision are 1, 2, 3, 4 very straight red lines. And those would be muons, muons that might have been produced in the decay of a Higgs boson, just like on the previous slide with a computer simulation. So here's another example from the CMS experiment. So you see a bunch more charged tracks. And you also see two big red towers of energy. So those towers of energy don't have a track. The fact they don't have a track means that they were deposited by neutral particles, maybe photons. And one of the things that we calculated back in 1975 was how the Higgs boson might decay into pairs of photons. So this could be evidence for another type of decay of the Higgs boson. So 2012, the LHC experiments announced the discovery of a new particle based on analysis of many events of the type that I just showed. And there was a big seminar in CERN. So here I pay particular tribute to Chris Whelan-Smith, who was the Director General of CERN, who got the LHC approved, and Lynn Evans, who was the physicist who actually built the LHC accelerator. And this picture I like. This is a picture of Peter Higgs on the right-hand side and François Englert, one of the co-inventors of this mass generation mechanism. And although they proposed their ideas 48 years previously, they had never met until this moment. So that's one of the reasons why I like this picture. The other one is it has an image of Fabiola Gianotti, who was the spokesperson of the ATLAS experiment, who co-announced the discovery, and who is now the CERN Director General. So at CERN, we have no glass ceiling. So what do these experiments see? Nothing. Well, over this range of possible Higgs bosons, what you see here is what the experiments observed, less the expected background from other standard model processes. And you see that within the statistical fluctuations, everything is consistent with no Higgs boson. But if you remove this blind here, you see there's a big peak associated with those photon events, those muon events, and that is what, when we discovered it, we didn't know exactly what it was. It was certainly something. And we asked ourselves, is this the Higgs boson finally emerging from the background? So in the years following the discovery of this new particle, there was quite an industry amongst us particle physicists of trying to understand whether this particle really is the missing piece of the particle Higgsaw puzzle. It's like you've been doing this 500-piece puzzle and finally you discover this piece of bent cardboard in the back of the sofa that's been chewed on by the dog. The picture's gone. But is this the piece that you were missing? So this is one of the things that I've been working on in recent years. So this is a plot taken from a paper I wrote with my PhD student, Tivong Yu. So we asked ourselves the question, this new particle, does it couple to other particles proportional to their masses? That's a key prediction of the standard model, right there on line 3. So we check line 3, and yes, it works. So the red line is the prediction. The dashed line is the best fit to the data. Everything is consistent. And so we wrote in our paper that this particle walks and quacks like a Higgs boson. Now, subsequent to our analysis, it's been done much better, much more professionally by the ATLAS and CMS collaborations. And this is the latest word on this subject. Again, perfect agreement between the standard model prediction and the couplings being proportional to mass. So, the discovery of the Higgs boson was important. Without it, there would be no atoms. Remember, those electrons would hope no mass. They would run away from nuclei at the speed of light. There'd be no heavy nuclei. The weak interactions would not be weak. Life would be impossible. The discovery of the Higgs boson was a big deal. And so that's why in 2013, Englert and Brout shared the Nobel Prize. And this is taken from the citation by the Nobel Prize Committee. Today, we believe that, beyond any reasonable doubt, it is a Higgs boson. So my student and I were quite proud because that quotation was taken directly from our paper. But there's a little backstory, which is that when we sent our paper to the journal to be published, the referee said, beyond any reasonable doubt, is not a scientific statement. So we had to take the quotation out in the published version of our paper. So it was good enough for the Nobel Prize Committee, but not good enough for the journal. So, what next? So, I'd like to paraphrase James Bond by saying that the standard model is not enough. And I give you 007 reasons for thinking that there has to be physics beyond the standard model. Empty space in the standard model is unstable. We don't explain the dark matter. We don't explain the origin of matter. We don't explain the sizes of particle masses. It doesn't explain why neutrinos have a mass. It doesn't explain why the universe is so big and old. And it doesn't provide a quantum theory of gravity. So there's many, many issues beyond the standard model. Some of those are solved, or at least mitigated, with a theory called supersymmetry that I'll be returning to later on. And many of these issues are going to be studied with experiments at the LHC. So in the remaining time, I'd like to briefly look at some of these outstanding problems. So first of all, this question of the stability of the universe. So theoretically, in the standard model, you can extrapolate its properties up to very high energies. And you can determine whether our electroweak vacuum, whether that snow field is stable or not, or whether there's going to be some sort of cosmic avalanche in the future. And that depends on the mass of the Higgs boson and the mass of the top quark. And so there's a boundary here up in that top region. It's unstable. Down here, it's stable. And the data, the measurements of the Higgs boson and the top quark mass, indicate that we're in this potential avalanche region. So my interpretation of that is that there must be new physics to stabilize the universe. So there's this question of whether the universe will collapse. Let me just briefly explain. So this horizontal axis is, if you like, the depth of the snow field. And we are currently here with a small snow field. But over there, there's a very deep pit where the density would be so large that the universe would collapse in a big crunch. Now, quantum fluctuations occur all the time, and there is some small probability that they will cause the universe to go from where we are now into that big crunch. So that's the issue that I've been talking about. In fact, there's another aspect of the problem, that very early in the history of the universe, those quantum fluctuations would have been much larger. And you don't understand why the universe didn't collapse in an avalanche right at the beginning. And that's the main reason why I think there has to be new physics, such as supersymmetry. So that was the first problem in the standard model. Second problem, dark matter. So this guy here is Fritz Wicki, who in the 1930s studied the galaxies in the Coma cluster. And he discovered that they were racing around very fast. And if you wanted to understand how they were held together in the cluster, you needed additional gravitational field beyond that generated by the visible matter. So he said there must be some invisible additional dark matter to hold the cluster together. So for about 40 years, people were not sure how seriously to take this argument. But in the 1970s, Vera Rubin studied the motions of stars in galaxies. And she found a very similar phenomenon, that those stars were running around faster than they should do. If you wanted the galaxy to be held together, you needed this additional dark matter. So this picture illustrates the problem. So here are the velocities of planets in the solar system. The velocities decrease as you go away from the sun because, of course, the gravitational field decreases. But here's what happens in a galaxy. The velocities don't go down like Kepler's laws say, they remain constant, and that tells you the gravitational field remains constant. That tells you there must be additional distributed dark matter to generate this additional gravitational field. So there's debate among particle physicists and astronomers as to what this dark matter might be. So, for example, since last year, there's been a lot of speculation that it might be made of black holes. But one possibility is that it's made of elementary particles, as yet unknown elementary particles, such as, for example, supersymmetric particles that we're currently looking for at the LHC. So the basic idea of supersymmetry is that in addition to all the known particles, there are other partners which are much heavier, and the lightest of those could be the dark matter. So this is a more detailed map of the supersymmetric world. So here are the standard model particles over on the left, and here are their supersymmetric partners over on the right. Generally, those supersymmetric partners are heavier than the known particles, according to the theory. And you know, one of the beauties of this theory that I don't really have time to describe is that by postulating supersymmetry, you could maybe hope to fix the overall masses of elementary particles. So, how about the search for dark matter? Well, of course, you can't see a dark matter particle directly because it interacts very weakly. It doesn't hit your detector, it goes out through it. But it carries energy and momentum. So what you do is look for events where there's a bunch of visible particles on one side of the detector and nothing visible on the other side. So to balance the energy momentum, there has to be something going up in that direction, which is represented by that red line there. So experiments have looked for that. No sign of dark matter yet. And it must be said, no sign of anything else at the LHC beyond the Higgs boson so far. And right now, those of us like me who love supersymmetry are trying to think how we can persuade her supersymmetry, we often call Susie, how we can persuade Susie to show herself. Now, one possibility is not to look for dark matter in collider collisions, but to look directly for dark matter, astrophysical dark matter. So we are swimming in a soup of dark matter particles, according to the theory. So every once in a while, one of those dark matter particles would hit some particle of regular matter, and maybe we could detect the collision. So there's a bunch of experiments in deep underground laboratories looking for such phenomena. So there's two tracks for looking for dark matter. There's the direct astrophysical track, and there is the indirect collider physics track. And this is a slide which compares the searches at the LHC, those are the red lines, with the searches directly for scattering of astrophysical dark matter, shown, for example, by these green lines. So there's competition between the two, and which of the two has the advantage depends on how that dark matter interacts with regular matter. So with this type of interaction, the direct search wins. With this type of interaction, it's the LHC that wins. So it's very important that these two parallel tracks looking for dark matter be continued. So a little bit about antimatter. So people are interested in antimatter because of Star Trek. They're interested because of angels and demons. But what, of course, what we physicists are interested in, we're not interested in blowing up the Vatican, and we're not interested in space travel, well, at least for the time being. What we're interested in is the question of how and why do matter and antimatter differ. So if I just go back to the 1920s for a moment, Dirac postulated the existence of antimatter in 1928, and he and everybody else thought that matter and antimatter would be exactly equal and opposite. Equal masses, opposite electric charge. And this was confirmed by experiment, and I might just remark, in sort of one sort of unexpected spin-off from fundamental physics, antimatter in the form of positrons are now used routinely in medical diagnosis using PET scanners. In the 1960s, it was discovered, to everybody's surprise, that actually matter and antimatter is not quite equal and opposite. Their weak interactions have very small differences. And the Russian physicist Sakharov suggested that maybe that very small difference between matter and antimatter might explain the origin of the matter in the universe. And so that's why, for example, at the LHC, we have a dedicated experiment that is studying all the different ways in which matter and antimatter differ and trying to make this connection with the origin of the matter in the universe. Another thing that we obviously are trying to do is to realize Einstein's dream of unifying the fundamental interactions. So here's Einstein again, looking a little bit older than in the previous picture. A little bit older, and maybe a little bit sad, you think? Maybe he had some premonition that he would not succeed in making a unified theory. So this is his last blackboard. His desk is almost as messy as mine. But his blackboard does not contain a unified theory. However, theoretical physicists are still now pursuing many of the ideas that he developed, in particular, the possibility that there might be extra dimensions of space. So this attracted a lot of attention a few years ago when the people who like alternative facts and fake news said, well, maybe the LHC is going to destroy the planet because it's going to make black holes, and those black holes are going to eat up the entire Earth. So we're still here. And we're still here because if those black holes were ever to be produced, they would vanish instantly. And you can't believe that there would be dangerous black holes anyway, because cosmic rays have been bombarding the Earth for billions of years. And they haven't destroyed us. So how is the LHC going to destroy us? Anyway, if those black holes were ever to be made at the LHC, that would be a fantastic laboratory for studying a quantum theory of gravity and thereby attacking number 7 on James Bond's list. So that pretty much brings me to the end of what I wanted to say. So this is a chart that was produced by The Economist magazine at the time of the Higgs discovery. And so this tells you how long it takes experimentalists to catch up on theorists. So sometimes, of course, the experiments come first, like, for example, the discovery of the tau lepton. But sometimes it takes a while. And in particular, in the case of the Higgs boson, it took 48 years between the particle being postulated and the particle being discovered. So that gave time for Peter Higgs to evolve from that to that. So I like to encourage my fellow lovers of SUSY and other physics beyond the standard model, be patient. Okay? Sometimes it takes a while. In the case of supersymmetry, it was postulated in 1971. Now we're 2017. It's only 46 years. So a few more years. Just be patient. So finally, where are we in our struggle to understand the universe? So we understand this bit, the visible matter. But there's all this other stuff out there, dark matter, and I didn't even discuss dark energy, which so far we have no direct evidence. And we have the Standard Model. And I am sure that the Standard Model will collide and sink. Thank you.
Thank you for this wonderful talk. I'm giving by the organizers this bag for you and would ask you that you maybe answer a few questions.
Sure.
If there are questions in the audience. But we don't have a lot of time, 5, at most 8 minutes. And I really encourage to ask a question. It's the most important part.
I won't go away until you ask them questions. Yeah, I think there are analogies. And one thing that I didn't mention because of lack of time was the historical precedence for the Englert-Brout-Higgs mechanism. And I think specifically Englert and Brout took their inspiration from condensed matter physics. So if you think back to the theory of superconductivity, okay, there we know that your electrons bind to form Cooper pairs. Those Cooper pairs form a medium, much like the Higgs field is a medium. And that medium gives a mass to the photon inside the superconductor. So the polaron phenomenon that you mentioned is somewhat similar. The electron, as it goes through the medium, through its interactions with the medium, it acquires this additional mass. It's very much like line three.
Fascinating talk. I'm not a theoretical physics or an experimental physics person. I'm a chemist working with molecules. And you made an interesting remark that mass is due to the interactions with the Higgs field, if I correctly understood it.
The masses of the elementary particles, yes.
Oh, okay. Because with molecules, interactions are strongly determined by size and shape, and not only by mass. The fact that you are all together is a lot to do with the size and shape of the molecules, how they interact. So doesn't that play a role?
Yeah, so I think that what you're talking about is the binding energy,
yeah,
which holds, for example, electrons in their orbits around nuclei. And so that was why I quickly slipped in this remark that I'm talking about mass at the level of the fundamental particles. And then when you stick those particles together, those interactions that were at the bottom of my Standard Model slide, those generate additional contributions or subtractions from the mass. So the attraction is a binding energy. In some cases, they add.
Okay. Thank you.
You talk when electron and positron will meet, they are transforming to the gamma quantum. What will happen if the neutrino and antineutrino will meet?
So they also can annihilate. They wouldn't, at some very, 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 very low level, they could annihilate through a photon. But predominantly, they would annihilate through one of the massive particles responsible for the weak interactions, the so-called Z boson. That's something that we haven't observed. We've, of course, observed the inverse process. And in fact, when I showed a slide of results from the LEP accelerator, that included the effects of the inverse process. And it was through the inverse process of the Z decaying into pairs of neutrinos that we could tell how many different types of neutrino species there are in the universe. Are there any students who don't have white hair? Oh!
In one of your slides, you mentioned about unifying theory.
Exactly. Sorry, I didn't mention the S word, but that's exactly what I had in mind. Quite frankly, I don't know. Many of us have proposed various different possible experimental signatures that might come from string theory, but none of us can put our hands on our hearts and say, okay, this is a key thing that you cannot avoid. And so it's a problem. And I think that's one of the reasons why, you know, there's a lot of critics of string theory out there. I once wrote a review article called String Theory, A Theory of Everything or of Nothing. So it's somewhat, no, still a little bit the same situation. That was why I was a little bit embarrassed when I saw the title of my talk, you know, A Brief Introduction to Everything or maybe A Brief Introduction to Nothing. Yes, at the back there. Okay, yes, the experimentalists do use neural networks. They're still a little bit suspicious of them. And I think that typically any experimental analysis that is produced by Atlas or CMS, it might have a neural network analysis, but there would also be a validation using more traditional techniques. But yes, neural networks are used extensively. And I would say that other aspects of what's called machine learning are also coming increasingly into play. Ben.
Yeah, my countryman, Erik Verlinde, recently proposed a theory about gravitation, which got a lot of rumor, I think, in the world, which was his idea was that gravity is due to information exchange. So is there anything on this theory that you could comment on, because that is completely new view, you know, and apparently there are schools here now in your community that reject or agree or...
Yeah, so I think that his ideas are very interesting, and I feel sort of somehow intuitively that there is some germ of truth in them. However, I haven't studied the theory in any detail. What I do see is appearing regularly on the archives, papers saying that it doesn't work. Okay. But I'm not able to give you a professional judgment on that. Personally, I think it's going to be very difficult to come up with an alternative to the standard dark matter plus dark energy paradigm. If somebody comes along and says, oh, they can explain everything, I'm skeptical. However, this basic kernel of this idea, that might, you know, be in there in the ultimate theory.
Was there any unplanned discoveries in the LHC? So usually just plan to see something, and then you either see it or not in the experimental data. But was there anything like spectacular which you could not explain?
So far, I'm afraid not. Okay. And I have to tell you this little anecdote. So in 1982 or 1983, Mrs. Thatcher, the then British Prime Minister, came to CERN, and she was introduced to a bunch of British physicists. What do you do, young man? So I said, well, I'm a theoretical physicist. My job is to think of things that the experimentalists could look for. But of course, I hope they find something different. Mrs. Thatcher liked things to be the way she liked them to be. Wouldn't it be better, young man, if they found what you predicted? So I said, well, if all they find is what is predicted, then we don't have clues for how to advance further. And so we're a little bit in the same situation at the moment. We discovered the Higgs boson. And so we're desperately looking to see whether there's some property of the Higgs boson that deviates from the standard model. Nothing so far. And of course, we're looking for other physics beyond the standard model. But I'm with you on this. We certainly hope that there's going to be something which may be something I haven't talked about at all, but not yet.
I am afraid that we have to relegate the questions maybe to personal coffee break talks, but we have 5 minutes over time, which is, I think, okay, but cutting time of the students' talks is also not nice. So I would propose to go on with the schedule and thank John really with my full heart for this.